Yo, ladies and gentlemen, I'm MC Zinnian, and welcome to my new mod reviewing platform. Look at this. Oh yeah, this is the new MC Zinnian official mod reviewing platform. It's huge. It's massive. It's 70 by 70. Well, the actual inside area is more like, I don't know, maybe 65, 66 by 70 or something like that. But yeah, it's huge. It's got a lot of decorations there on the outside, some cockpits and everything. And then up there, we have the Skybox Dyson Sphere. I can't remember who made it, but yeah, it looks absolutely epic. But anyway, so welcome back to Space Engineers Weekly Workshop Roundup number 11. Today is going to be a little bit of a transitional episode because this is going to be the last traditionally filmed Space Engineers Weekly Workshop Roundup. And well, by that I mean this is going to be the last one that where I literally run through everything like live, like commenting live. The next episode, Space Engineers Weekly Workshop Roundup number 12, is going to be a little bit more highly edited, so watch out for that in the near future. Hopefully next week, if not the week after. Depends on how long I take sort of getting used to the new way of doing things. But yeah, so this episode is probably going to be a little bit briefer than normal because we simply don't have that much to talk about. So first up, we've got the LCD Force Landscapes Texture Pack by AssHunter, and that is this right here. So all of these guys are LCDs, and they've got pictures of Force and stuff as textures. So, yep, very interesting, very pretty pictures, and as you can see, they each take up more than one LCD. So yeah, this shot here, as you can see, it takes up three. I think I got one here that takes up two. I don't have one that, oh yeah, here's one that takes up two right here. This is my favorite. Now it does have a third picture for an LCD panel that sort of goes over there, but it looks just as good with two, I think. Now, you may be wondering, how in the world do I actually get these pictures on my LCDs? Well, to do that, you go up to the LCD and you activate it using the K key, and then you find the particular picture you want in loaded textures. So for instance, if I wanted Landscape Force Green 1A, I would click on that and then click Add to Selection. It would pop up down here. If I wanted to remove something, I would click it and then click Remove Selected. But so the way this works is there are different environments. In fact, I think there are three different environments. There are actually two different environments, but so there are two different environments, and then three different shots within each environment. So the A represents which shot you're choosing, and the number represents which picture in that shot that you're choosing. It's kind of hard to explain, but to show you what I'm talking about, I am going to actually do this. I'm gonna go over here to this one, and I'm going to select. I want the green environment, and I want to use the first shot here, which is the shot that's on the left. So I'm gonna go down here and remove this one and then select landscape for screen 1A. And then that's going to change it to that. And then for the other one over here, to make it match up with the one on the left, I would choose landscape forest green 2A, or rather, it's not changing. So sorry about that little jump cut there, but yeah, so as you can see, I've changed this picture here to landscape forest green 2A. So that's sort of that's how you sort of put these things together. So you choose the environment and then the shot that you want to use, and then you sort of just basically, it's hard to explain, but you sort of match up the numbers and the letters and everything. But it's hard to explain, but it's not really hard to do once you learn how to do it. So if you're still unclear on what exactly I'm talking about, you can just go and download it on the Space Engineers Steam Workshop page. You just subscribe to it and load it up in your world and just play around with it, because it's actually pretty easy to get these things all put together and everything once you actually learn how they work. So yeah, pretty useful for just curing homesickness in your space engineers and your crew and everything, so they could go down to the mess or wherever you have these and look at them and just be reminded of home and just sort of think back to planet Earth. So pretty nice. And I just want to point out the resolution of these things is absolutely stupid for a shot, for a space engineer's texture rather. I mean, they hold up about right here is when you really start to see some of the pixelation, but yeah, they're pretty good textures indeed. So yeah, now we are moving on to decorative cables and wires with lights by KU07BA. And yeah, it's pretty much just decorative cables. That's literally the sum total of it. There are several different types of cables. I mean, like, huge. Maybe, let's count here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. So there are 20 different cable blocks here, and they're pretty much just for ambiance. I mean, they don't really serve a purpose, but like if you just wanted everything to look a little bit, let's say, more basic and low tech, you could just put these guys down on the floors or walls or what have you, and just have some bare wires running around to really reinforce the idea that, you know, your ship or station or whatever really isn't that high tech at all. So kind of neat, if I do say so myself. So you've got some of these that all wavy and stuff, and then you've got some more that are a little bit straighter, and then some that are very straight. So pretty cool stuff for just a little bit of ambiance, you know. It doesn't really serve a purpose, like I said. They're just decorative, but they look cool in many different situations. And then finally, now you see what I mean when I said that this is going to be a little bit of a brief episode. AidylHeid's kitchen / galley / mess hall decorations. Currently there are 13 blocks in the set. They're all shown off over here. You got two fridges and cabinets, which is strange because it looks like three to me unless these guys are the same block. These two gray guys are the same block, and just put them into two different hotbars. It would be a little bit weird, but so yeah. So you've got these guys that are sort of stainless steel colored. Got sort of cabinets and sinks and everything. You got basically two of everything. Two fridges and cabinets, two straight double cabinets, which I think are these. Two inset stove and oven cabinets. Two sinks, two corners, five islands with three stools apiece. And three wood tables and chairs, one for OCD players and two for realism. And two mess hall benches. So these are the mess hall benches right over here, and these are just the dining table sort of things. Very cool. If you want to make just a house, you know, you could just use this, because look at it. It's got like wood finishing and you've got stainless steel appliances. There's not really anything that's too sci-fi about this. So if you want to build a very plausible sort of planet-side house, you could just use this. You know, you got bar stools, you got really everything you need, and it doesn't look like it's from the spaceship. The aesthetic is very cool, very clean, very modern. Oh yeah, these are the two ovens here. You just got one with stainless steel cabinets and one with wooden cabinets. Pretty much just like everything else in the mod. And of course you got a sink over there and two, well, these aren't sinks, but so you got two different kinds of sink basically. Yeah, it's very aesthetically pleasing, I find. One thing that you will notice though is that all of the seats are, you can't sit in them quite yet. I believe that may be something that the mod author may be working on. That's just pure speculation though, because I certainly haven't seen any evidence that he's working on that. It doesn't have that, doesn't mention that in the description, but it would be sort of cool to have in there. You know, you could have a space engineer sitting here at the bar and just sort of drowning his sorrows through his visor somehow. Yeah, it would look cool. This really, really, really looks cool. I especially like the slate countertops. So, in order to show you guys all this in action, I built sort of a kitchen slash dining room area under the mod viewing platform. So I'm gonna go down there now and show you guys exactly what these things look like in action. So I'll see you guys on the other side. So here we are in my kitchen slash dining room area. And yeah, it's a little bit tiny, I will admit. It's a little bit tiny and just a touch dark because there's not much space here to put lights and everything. But so check this out. That is a shot of the mouth of a cave with a little waterfall there. And there's some trees and just feel all of the ambiance that sort of adds to this entire area. I mean, I made so dark, and I made these armor panels black just so that this would be sort of like a focal point here. I think it works rather well. You know, because from a certain distance, you can't really tell that that's just a picture. You could almost sort of, you could really feel the ambiance. You know, you almost feel like you're there with that incredibly, incredibly high resolution sort of texture there. And we've got a couple of dining tables here and a bar. Now I will say that the bar doesn't quite match up with the counter pieces as far as alignment is concerned, but I think that may just be so that the stools could have collision, because Keen Software House and their sometimes infinite wisdom, for some reason they decide it'd be incredibly cool and awesome to make it so that anything outside of the bounding box can't have collision. So, yeah, it's sort of a sacrifice that pretty much has to be made, which is rather unfortunate. But so, yeah, it's pretty awesome. If I do say so myself, if a little tiny here. So, and you've also got the cables down here, just sort of to create the illusion that they're running to a different part of the station, even though they really aren't. They do have a little bit of something in their own way. Although I think they would be a little bit better used on, say, a command deck where there are a lot of control stations and everything. But overall, I think they look pretty decent and definitely add a little bit of a character to the room. So now we're onto the ships, and I want to bring your attention to to this guy over here. Now, you're probably saying that's just a box, MCC. It's a box with landing pads. I saw those landing pads. You can't fool me, MCC. It has landing pads. It's just a box. What's so special about it? Check this. Huh? It's a little ship. It's a little ship. Now, this is honestly one of the coolest things I've ever seen. If only just for the shutters and the way that they sort of close to make it look like a cargo container. But no, it's a little sneaky, tiny little ship, and this is the Jekyll, Hyde system by Digitall. It's an idea spawned from trying to make a ship with ablative armor like the Voyager. This is a ship that can hide in plain sight as a container in a dock or floating in space. So, yeah, you have to admit, that concept is all sorts of neat. If you want a cloaking system, a very basic cloaking system that could be very effective in many scenarios, there you go, just right there. So we're gonna hop into this guy real quick and give him a little bit of a fly. Now first you've got to kick on the engines, which is a little bit unusual, so you do that by pressing 5 on the number key row at the top of your keyboard, and so we are flying around, and it actually handles pretty good. It doesn't have that much side thrust, but it does have quite a lot of turning capability, especially for a ship that almost weighs 50,000 kilograms, and I would assume doesn't have that many gyroscopes. That's a little bit of a zoomed out view there, gang. So let's actually go and, as you can see, the ship is very, very sprightly. It's got plenty of power thanks to those large thrusters on the back, and yeah, for what it does, it handles it very well. So you could you can imagine that this would be a pretty effective ship for just hiding, not only because of that clever little cloaking system, but also because of the fact that, you know, if it's discovered or if the pilot's suspicious, they could just GTFO. It's got plenty of thrust to get it out of most sticky situations. So we're gonna hide it again. We're gonna land it here and hide it very, very cleverly down ever so carefully. Oh, by the way, yeah, you can engage the cloaking system from within the cockpit. That's number 1 on the hotbar. But if you do that, then obviously the rear sort of slidey out things are gonna be directly behind the engine, so you better hope you don't have thruster damage on otherwise. I have a sneaking suspicion those would not last too long. But other than that, fantastic little ship. Great freaking idea. I mean, this this is easily one of the most unique things I've ever seen on Space Engineers, and I've reviewed some ships, as you may well know. And I've played with some other ships in my spare time. I've probably got over 50 ships in total that I've either reviewed or played with one time. So for something to be this unique to me is kind of rare, and it's definitely a very ingenious idea for just hiding. Well, as long as the containers you're hiding amongst look exactly like this, but we're gonna overlook that because this is so novel, and the ship it contains is actually a joy to fly. Like, it's so cool, guys. It's ridiculously awesome. So I'm gonna put this guy down here, and we're going to uncloak ourselves, and then go over and review the Devourer Dreadnought by N. So let's kick off the engines here, and then open up. And then once these guys are opened up all the way, we're just gonna hop out. Oh, by the way, you can't actually hop out while those are closed. If you do that, you sort of end up on the inside. And in case that happens, there's a little button here that you can press to open up the front. But you I forgot gravity was upside down there. But there's a little button on the front down here that you can actually use to close just the front rather than opening and closing the entire cloaking system. So, man, hats off to Digitall, because that was ridiculously unique. So yeah, the Dreadnought Devourer by N. Yeah, look at this bastard. Look at this thing. I admit it looks a lot bigger, or it looked a lot bigger in the screenshots, but this thing looks absolutely fearsome. I mean, look at it. Look at all the thrusters. Look at the black and blue armor. Look at the overall shape. I mean, ooh, yeah. This is definitely a Dreadnought, if I've ever seen one. And by Dreadnought, I mean, you better dread this thing, because if you don't dread this thing, you're pretty freaking stupid, and it's probably gonna wreck your face. So, I'm not exactly sure what it has in the way of armament, but it has no mods, no rotors, and, get this, no pistons. So, no elevators, no fancy anything, just pure death. Look at all the guns. This thing has some pretty decent broadside power. I mean, it's not built for broadsiding, it's more built for carrying small ships in its hangar, but for what it does, it's got some firepower. Those are Gats there. I think it may have a couple of missile turrets. I didn't really take enough time to sort of go around and just look at all the guns, which I probably should have done, but we're just gonna fly on in here just like that. And you have to kind of beware, because in certain areas it doesn't have gravity. So in fact, this entire front area has no gravity until we get, I think, past the hangar door. This is the front hangar door, and there's a warhead. I don't know how I didn't notice that at first. I can't exactly seem to figure out how to activate that. Or was that not the front hangar door? Kind of weird. Yeah, it's a little bit easier to get turned around in this particular hangar. Where's the front hangar door? Oh, there it is. So, Yeah, you basically got this little two-level hangar thing here, which is kind of cool because it allows you to store more ships. So you can store a pretty decent amount up here if you really, really cram it full. I mean, parking ships not only on the bottom but the sides, the top, you could probably store maybe 10-15 ships depending on the size. But down here you've got room for even more, so you're not going to really run out of space too soon. I mean, granted, down here you don't have as many surfaces to sort of latch onto. You basically only got the bottom, but it's pretty cool. Although I wonder if the mod creator or the ship creator didn't intend to perhaps add a hangar door here, because this is a little bit of a weakness. If all of your fighters are out engaging other ships, somebody could just easily sneak in here and wreck a lot of stuff. So it's a bit of a weakness, so you'd have to really play it safe, tactically speaking. Down here, I actually didn't notice that there's a down here part. This appears to basically just be an empty sort of area here. Never mind, it was a little bit upside down. By the way, just ignore this thruster damage here. For some reason, this is supposed to be a mainsail here, but it decided to explode when I pasted the ship in. But here we find ourselves in a little medbay sort of area with a couple of cryo chambers. So pretty basic stuff, and yeah, to get this to have oxygen, you have to patch this all up, which is a little tiny bit annoying. I will admit, I don't know why that happened. I think it may have been because of that. Thruster being behind some armor there, but I believe pretty much all of this is. I believe this little area here is pretty much sectioned off from the rest of the ship. So I'm going to go in this side entrance. I'll see you guys there and we can explore the rest of the ship. How's that sound? Good? Good? All right. Sweet. See you then. So in order to get in to the ship proper, you have to go in through here. Through these little side entrance things. Let me actually zoom out so we can get a better idea. They're just behind the bridge there. So, it's kind of a little hidden, I guess. Not too much, though. So, there's a button panel that opens up the hangar, and then you can just go straight in and pop this button here and it closes it again. The interior to this thing is rather complex. As you can see, everything's fully conveyored up, which I would imagine is pretty much a nightmare of just complex freaking conveyor systems, because it's got a lot of guns, it's got a lot of oxygen tanks, and I would imagine even some places to store your cargo. So hugely complex little area. So this is the right side airlock, and to get up to the bridge, etc., we go up here, and then there's a little tiny door, and then close that, and then the bridge is right here, I believe. This is the bridge area, and this is how you get to the rest of the ship. I completely lied. The way to get to the rest of the ship is actually right here. So yeah, to get to the rest of the ship, you have to go through the bridge, which is kind of weird because that would create a major traffic point through the bridge for any sort of crew wanting to work, like up here, for instance, in the front of the ship. Now, I'm gonna warn you guys, you may die of sci-fi awesome when I walk down this tunnel, so make sure you put your glasses on. I'm gonna put my glasses on for sure. There we go, glasses on, just so I don't die of sci-fi awesomeness. So, are you ready? 5, 4, let's do it anyway! Yeah. Look at this. Look at this, you get a nice, nice view to the outside world amidst all this heavy armor and stuff. By the way, the ship weighs over 53 million kilograms, but it doesn't exactly move slowly. We'll get to that in a second. But so you get a nice view, beautiful view to the Dyson Sphere, or outer space if you don't live in a Dyson Sphere. Yeah, the gravity just sort of stops as you get to the front of the ship, which is kind of weird. But then so we go down here. Instead we go down here. There we go. We go down here, thank you, door. And down here, I believe this is engineering. Well, yeah, this is kind of engineering. This is where you would go to oversee all of the connectors and stuff. So they're just right down there. You got a lot of different stuff that's all connected and everything. Quite a few large containers as well, and then some interior blocks. And that sort of thing. So, and then we move forward, and then this is the gyroscope room slash, well, not gyroscope, but gravity generator room slash, well, cryopod room. I don't know why there are cryopods there. Kind of weird, but they're all sort of linked up, so I guess they're linked to an oxygen system. So that's cool. I just now thought of that. And I actually haven't been through this part of the ship. So it's quite expansive, as you would imagine. And then in here we've got just sort of a little empty area here with a hangar door for some reason. That's strange. Airtight hangar door. Oh, yeah, this is to the outside. I recall that now. Little airtight hangar door that leads to the outside of the ship. Yep, so sort of in here. I say the outside because it's not really all covered up and everything. It's still behind this armor. So just a little tiny balcony, I guess, for you to sort of go and relax without gravity. And so we're gonna close that up. Bang. And then moving through this door, I wonder what we have here. Just sort of, I guess, oversight for the oversight sort of thing? This is kind of weird. I thought I explored the entire ship, I swear. But yet, so you get a little bit of a view there out onto the little pathway there, and then this just leads, well, to another sort of area. But I'm going to just go and explore what I know, so that way we can sort of cut this a little bit shorter. So this is actually the main cockpit. I forgot that this was actually even down here. But check this out. So this is really, really cool. It's hidden away well within the bowels of the ship, as you can see by where the camera's sort of centered. So, yep, check this out. It's got a gravity drive. So this is what this ship is capable of on just regular sort of thruster energy. But if we cut the gravity drive on, as you can see on the bottom there, the mass block is already on. But if we cut the gravity drive on, by the way, I believe 2 is forward drive. As you can see, we're all of a sudden accelerating way faster. Like, way fast. We're already up to 50 meters a second. So, this is really, really interesting because it sort of opens up quite a few different sort of possibilities for battlefield maneuvering. just remembered to turn my inertia dampeners off there. Yep, this is easily the fastest large ship we have ever tested here with this gravity drive. It's generating a massive 20 Gs of sheer forward propulsion, which is insane. And as you can hear, we've got quite a number of gravity generators on the job. So we're already up to 370 meters a second, which is over 300 miles an hour, huge speeds. And the skybox I have limits the speed, so it tops out at 421.5. So now we are scooting on along at quite the pace. So check this out, to stop, you turn off the forward propulsion and you turn on the gravity generator in slot number one, and then you turn on the inertia dampeners as well to get just that little extra bit of stopping power. As you can see, that little series of dots back there, that little tiny structure in the background, that's the mod viewing platform. We managed to get to 421.5 meters a second in a very short space, especially for the size of this ship and the fact that it weighs over 55 million kilograms with all of this heavy armor and stuff. So yep, it's a little bit of a weapon. It's a little bit of a weapon. So I think just sort of as a cool way to round this review of the ship off, I think we should plow it into the mind viewing platform, because why not? I mean, guys, this is MC Zinman we're talking about. Oh yeah, we're backing up. So you gotta be a little bit particular about this sort of thing. Alright, so let's just get it stopped here. And then aim for the mod reviewing platform. So here we go, guys. I've got dead in my sights. Are you ready? Yeah, I don't know if we're actually going to hit it. That's the thing. But yeah, we're definitely going to be scooting. We may just clip straight through it, actually. Inertia dampeners off. I think we may actually want them on so that we can aim a little bit better. Come on, hit it. This is gonna be interesting. We're riding up just a little bit. Oh, this is gonna be cool. This is gonna be so cool if we hit it. Please hit it. That'd be like awesome. By the way, I'm choosing to use my inertia dampeners just to make the thing a little bit more precise, because it's not exactly easy to aim this at a target, as you might imagine. Yeah, we're gonna go like just straight over it. Ah, man. Yo, that would have been so cool if we hit that, you know? Actually, let's bring it to bear here. I'm gonna hit this one way or another. This is gonna take a while to stop. I think we're going straight on for it. Are we? Yeah. We're definitely gonna miss it by a lot less this time. Ah, man, we just barely nicked it. Oh yeah. Oh, man. Oh. Ah, oh, yep, and now we have sent our station tumbling through space. This has been a good day. Look at that thing tumble. I'm gonna actually get out and go and take a look at all the damage we've done to it. So I'm just gonna move on to the next mod, which is actually, the next land vehicle, which is actually in a different world. So, see you guys on the other side. So this is it, the TTC Mobile Command Carrier by One Cog Coggernaut. And yeah, this is the same world that we were just in last episode, as you can see by all that stuff over there. So yep, this is, in fact, I believe One Cog Coggernaut's hut is somewhere around here. It's somewhere around here, but so yeah, this is actually the second time he's been featured on the Space Engineers Weekly Workshop Roundup. So everybody in the comments, give One Cog Coggernaut a very big round of applause for being only the second Space Engineer to be featured in the Weekly Workshop Roundup twice in a row. So this is the Mobile Command Carrier. As you can see, absolutely zero, none, nada, mods whatsoever. And despite that, it is a huge freaking truck. Yeah, well, it's not as big as that prospecting vehicle, the Sim HVPV heavy prospecting vehicle. But it's pretty big. And this guy is actually meant to be a mobile base more so than the mobile, than the prospecting vehicle over in that lane direction. So it's pretty small for what we usually review here, but it's pretty decently sized by any other means. So we're gonna get straight into it here. It's fully oxygenated, by the way, except for the hangar. If I can actually close the door for once in my life, that would be great. So yep, it's oxygenated, as you can tell in the airlock that has an oxygen vent in it for some reason. Kind of a strange choice. But I guess you depressurize that actually if you were about to head out. So you close this, depressurize that, and then open that door, and everything would sort out itself and be handy dandy awesomeness. Straight ahead, you've got the cockpit, complete, I should say, rather. English I can some days of the week. But, so you've got a cockpit here, and a nice little view outside that gives you a very good idea of exactly where you're going, what you're doing, and then exactly how to go about things and everything like that, and it's pretty awesome! And in case you haven't noticed already, this is very much a vertical vehicle. It's very tall and not very wide, which makes it a little bit top heavier, but it also makes it so that it can sort of fit in places a little bit better, I guess. Up here, this is literally straight up, by the way, this is the top of the vehicle. You get a medical room, and then straight ahead, you get this little area here. So, very basic also. You can see what I was saying by not very big. So, yeah, there's your med bay and your other med bay and your conveyor. I believe it has a couple of connectors on the outside too, so you could hook up a little mining rover vehicle, whatever, to the connectors and just sort of take it around with you. So that's literally the entire thing, I believe. Yeah, that's the door to the hangar, so we're going to give this thing a little bit of a drive, shall we? So let's actually go here and do this. And by the way, I do want to point out that this cockpit, first of all, I'm not sure that this is actually the cockpit that you're sort of supposed to drive it from, because this world has been known to have some issues with cockpits, as you saw in the previous episode if you watched it. So the ship may in fact come with a cockpit up top on the top floor, but I can't be too sure. So this ship, this cockpit rather, isn't usually assigned to control the wheels. So what I've had to do is I've had to open it up. It's a flight seat too, and I've had to tick control wheels. So we're going to bring it to a stop right now, and then I'm gonna zoom out first so I can actually see what I'm doing. Gosh dang. And yeah, it doesn't drive very well. Hold on, let me make sure we don't have any artificial mass blocks. We do not, in fact, have any artificial mass blocks. You can stop now, thank you. Before you drive into that. Yeah, it's really hard to drive. I have a feeling this is made to be used with natural gravity. So, doesn't have any artificial mass blocks. We've gotten the thing completely off the ground. Stop! I command you! So yeah, very, very awkward to drive without natural gravity, but so we're gonna get it stopped and turned and stopped and turned somehow. And yeah, it's really, really awkward to drive without artificial, or without natural gravity. Nothing artificial about natural gravity, MCZ. Ah! Welcome to MC Zinman, where I regularly make noises like that. Okay, so it does have some pretty decent acceleration because it's so light, only 567,000 kilograms. But the thing is, it's incredibly hard to turn because virtually none of that gets to the ground. By default, we're going to try to avoid that rock. And we are not going to try to avoid the heavy prospecting vehicle. Let's get some speed. Speed! Speed is key, as Jacksepticeye would say. Okay, let's hit it. Let's hit it. Oh no, that thing's gonna get in the way. Go! Get through there. Get through that. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. We have fused. We have become one. Yes. My life is complete. I've officially crashed two land vehicles in Space Engineers. Of all things. Okay, so it looks like we still got a semi-functioning vehicle here. Let's go and, well, I didn't place down his little station thingy. One called Coggernaut's little station deal thing. Oh, I was gonna run over that next. Ah, dang it. Okay, so while we're at, we might as well just drive it on home here. Do not come off the ground. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Okay, that's enough speed. That's enough speed. Stop now. Stop now. Stop now. Stop now. It's a little bit hair-raising driving this. We are completely off the ground. We have lost contact with the floor. Oh, no. Okay, get back down. Thank you. Yeah, this is definitely a unique challenge, shall I say. I honestly think this is built for natural gravity, because we are generating exactly 2 g's of gravity. I pressed something. Let's see, okay. Get a little bit more speed. Yep, a little bit more speed. Can we hit 20? We cannot, but this is going to be awesome! Hibiski, we have committed suicide, and we are stuck between these things. Stop! Stop! Stuck! Stuck! Okay, okay. Everything's cool. We're fine. We're fine. We're fine. Everything is fine. Everything is fine. Those two vehicles are fused there. Everything is fine, though. That was interesting. That was really something. But yeah, so if you've got natural gravity, I mean, go ahead and just give this thing a go. I mean, there's no doubt in my mind at this point that it's meant for natural gravity, because I certainly couldn't drive it. So it's cool. It's cool for just being a mobile base. Certainly a concept we don't see much of on the Space Engineers Steam Workshop page, and certainly something I've never had the pleasure of reviewing in the Space Engineers Weekly Workshop Roundup. But if you like this video, then go ahead and bitch at that like button. If you really, really like it and you want to see more, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. Hey, I've been MC Zinman. You've been awesome. I'll see you guys in the next video. MCZ out.